We are speaking with Artie Pepin, Director of the Administrative Office of the Courts. Thanks for sticking around.
We spent
12 minutes or so talking about something that you've been talking about for years. So I know there's much more to get to than we have time to address. I wanted to talk about the public safety assessment, the tool, the PSA, that specifically Bernalillo County has been using and judges use to evaluate the risk of reoffense and flight risk, essentially, some subcategories there. How do you feel that that system is working in terms of its predictive capabilities?
Well, people might be interested in how I feel about it. I would look to the data. That's the whole reason why we gave all of the cases that we could, 10,000 cases that had started and finished, because you can only measure success in pretrial when a case is finished, because the pretrial period lasts up till it's finished. We talk about pretrial, but pre-plea, pre-dismissal, pre-whatever. So those are finished cases. That's why we gave all of that information to the PhD people over there at the university and asked them to answer some questions for us. Is the study predictive on risk of arrest during the pretrial period for another crime? Is it predictive of a likelihood of appearing in court? So it's public safety rate. You know, if 80% of the people appear, they get an 80% public appearance rate.
Okay.
And public safety rate, if 80% of them don't get arrested, you've got an 80% public safety rate. So looking at that data, yes, the instrument, I mean, the report concludes that it's valid, it's predictive, and also some very important questions we ask them, is it biased? Because some of these instruments that have been used in other places have had a problem where when you look at the data, you find they're biased against a gender or a race, ethnicity. So we asked those questions too. And in looking at all the data they found, it had no demonstrable bias in any of those categories. And so that was good.
Okay. And I just, before you continue, I wanted to spend a moment on that bias. That's basically saying that in some of these models, they look at the arrest rates of people of color, the Black community, the Latinx community, and they say these people historically have been more likely to be arrested and charged.
Yes.
So this is oversimplifying, but it's the garbage in, garbage out thing. If you're taking bad arrest data, you're going to get bad predictive data. You're not finding that.
That has generally been the problem, and I want to be clear. No study has said that of the PSA, the public safety assessment that we use, or the Arnold tool, sometimes it's called that, because it was developed by a nonprofit, Arnold Foundation. Nobody said that about the PSA, but we have to get the PSA analyzed to see if it does that here. And where there's been trouble, it's largely been because these instruments use arrest data, and arrest data it can be predictive, as it turns out, of risk when you're arrested again for a new charge, but also can be quite biased because for the reasons you mentioned, because of policing practices. We don't have any evidence that those policing practices were in place in Albuquerque, but you asked the question because you don't want to go on what I think. I'm not qualified to do the math they did. I read the report and I conclude that they must know what they're talking about, but they tell us that it is not biased for race, ethnicity, gender, and for the first study of which we're aware in the country, Native American population. We're not aware of any validation study of any instrument, including the PSA, that involved a Native American community. And they found it was not biased there either, which means the instrument is making recommendations about risk level that are consistent across all those factors. That is, they're non-factors in what kind of risk you get assigned. So you don't get assessed a higher risk because you're a woman instead of a man or vice versa, anything like that. That's good news. That's the essential reason why you get a validation study. But of course, in looking at the 10,000 cases, you learn a lot of other things, and some of that can point you in the direction of how you could do better on outcomes for public safety and appearance rate.
The PSA ranks people or rates them, puts them in different classes, and you took a look at, or the ad hoc committee took a look at, I believe, how many detention motions were filed for each class. The most severe end of the scale, and I can see you've got data there, so feel free to find
it. But
one of the things that caught me as I was looking at it was at the most severe end of the scale, you don't have a 90% rate of prosecutors filing for detention motions. What did you find, and what does the data suggest is the reason for that?
Oh, I can't tell you the reason why the district attorney makes that decision, because they have to decide. There were not quite 5,000 cases, 4,995, over the course of this study, that the instrument rated people at maximum condition or detained, but of course the court can't detain unless there's a motion. But, you know, it's an oversimplification, as you say, but you have people who are in the green category, very low risk. People in the yellow category, we should impose conditions on them to help them not get rearrested and show up. And then the red category, where we should be extremely careful about release and the conditions of release to make sure we're protecting public safety and they're likely to return. So there were almost 5,000 rated in the red, that red detain or maximum condition category. And the district attorney brought a motion for detention in about 20% of those cases, 985 of them. And in bringing those 985 motions, the success rate, the grant rate, the rate at which they were granted, was about 80%.
Okay.
Now, on the other end of the scale, the district attorney brought motions in the lowest category, the green box people, the low-risk people. And the success rate, the grant rate, was still 20%, even in the lowest-risk category. So the judges weren't... They don't just follow the recommendations of the PSA. The PSA has data, which the judges get, including a criminal history and other things. And the DA can present pretty much any kind of evidence they want to try to convince a judge this person should be held, whether they're rated low risk by the instrument or high risk. But as to why the district attorney only brought a motion for detention on 20% of the people rated high, I guess you'd have to ask district attorney. Some conversations I've had with prosecutors, I don't know if they haven't studied the PSA or if they were waiting to see if it was valid before they relied on it, or maybe they just didn't think it was valuable. We do. A PSA is done before a person ever appears in front of a judge. So you get arrested on Monday, you're going to be in front of a judge Tuesday. A PSA will be done. We have people working overnight. They do a PSA. So the judge, the defense attorney, if there is one, which there usually is, and the prosecutor all have that information, so they have the criminal history and all of that. There may be other factors that the district attorney wants to use in deciding whether to bring a motion or not, but that's what the data says. About 20% of the maximum condition or detained people had a detention motion.
Okay. You talk about how much the system can rely on that. It's sort of underscores the importance of making sure there isn't bias in that tool, because if everyone is looking at the score going into it, they're sort of inherently leaning on it to some extent, as you said.
Well,
it's not 100%.
The point is to use data. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
The point is to give our judges data on which they can make informed decisions. You know, before 2017, judges couldn't detain people, and they had to release people. And we had a bond schedule, and we had bonds, right? We set money. So the judge would use whatever information they had on a person and say, you can get out of jail before you go to trial for $500, $1,000, $10,000, 10% of $10,000, whatever it was, right? And we didn't really do a good job of giving them a lot of information to make that decision on. We adopted arbitrary schedules. If you're charged with a fourth-degree felony, it's a $1,000 bond or 10%. $100, you can be out. We didn't assess them for risk, that they were dangerous. The bondsman who posted those bonds, when it was a commercial bond, which was very often, had no responsibility to supervise them for risk of committing another crime or anything like that. So anyway, in the new system, we are trying to give judges information they can use to make an informed decision. It doesn't bind the judges by any means, and they can make their own assessment. Besides the score, which they know what the score means in terms of how the instrument works, they can see the criminal history, they can see if they've had a violent offense, they can see how recently they failed to appear, if they had prior cases and things like that. And, as I said, the district attorney can present evidence that's not even in the PSA, of course. And it could be from anywhere. The Supreme Court has made it very clear that you can present anything you want. The judge will have to decide how persuasive it is. You know, if you got a letter from somebody's cousin who said something that would make you be concerned about their threat to public safety, you could present that. The judge may or may not, you know, find that persuasive, but anything can be presented.
Okay. Have you found, I know that's not in use, the PSA is not in use statewide, have you found that it's more effective in ensuring appearance and preventing reoffense than just judges sort of handling this the way they always have?
We haven't evaluated, well, we know that the rearrest rate was high before, right, when, for people who got out, but the getting out was fairly random. That is, if you had enough money, you got out. You could be the lowest risk person in the system, but if you don't have $500, you can't get out of jail. So it's not really fair to compare the data, because who got out didn't have anything to do with who was risky. So if the rate was really high or really low, it had more to do with whether low-risk people had more money or high-risk people had more money to get out. But we do look at national data and all that, and of course, data from New Mexico. We've implemented the PSA in other district courts and other counties. We're moving through the state to implement it everywhere. And we have found public safety rates and appearance rates in those places consistent with Bernalillo County. And the Bernalillo County, this giant study of 10,000 cases, is pretty consistent with a lot of other jurisdictions around the country who have gone to risk-based release in terms of appearance rate and public safety rate. Some do better. Probably the gold standard is the District of Columbia. They've got about a 90% public safety rate. We've got 81%. We'd love to get there. They've been at it for about 30 years. And so we can learn things from them about that. If you look at data and you compare it, you also have to keep in mind that we in Bernalillo County are only looking at felonies. We only do that for, all the data is on felonies, the PSA for felonies. Every other jurisdiction that uses the PSA applies it to felonies and misdemeanors. Mm. Now, if you looked at a history of a combination of felony and misdemeanors, your misdemeanors rarely get arrested for any offenses that are scary. I mean, you know, those
sure.
First, second, third degree felonies, because they're misdemeanors. That's their level of criminal activity they're facing, and they're just low risk for public safety threat. They tend to have a little more trouble with appearance rate, although we can do things to mitigate that, like we're doing, like reminder texts to people's phones to tell them, you have a court date tomorrow, Mr. Misdemeanor, please show up. So, you know, you have to really get in the weeds on things to see if you're comparing anything that's comparable. But the study we got from the ISR at the UNM shows us that, at least as a starting matter, from when we began till now, we're at least achieving public safety rates and appearance rates that are consistent with other places. And we can work to get especially the public safety rate higher. And this gives us a lot of information to help us do that.
How much of this issue goes away to any extent with additional funding for the courts, more judges, more courtrooms, that sort of thing?
Well, I'd love to say that we could make the whole system better if we just focused on the courts, because that's my area. The whole system has to be properly funded. There have to be resources throughout the system. The district attorney has to have the resources to make a determination that's evidence-based on whether to bring a motion for detention on dangerous people. The public defender has to be able to represent people in a way that's effective so that we're not sending people to jail because they had bad poor representation or not inadequate representation from people who are overwhelmed. The police need to be able to arrest people who commit crimes, right, in the system. And we have to have the ability to have all of those things come together fairly quickly when someone's arrested so the judges can make an informed decision about what conditions to release them on or if there's a motion to detain them on. With regard to specifically to the courts, the legislature's been very generous in funding our efforts to take pretrial services statewide. After all, if you're a judge, not in Bernalillo County, but in some other county, and you're under the old system except with new rules, right? You are allowed to detain people if there's a detention motion. You have to release most people and you have to set conditions of release. But if you don't have pretrial services, if you can't tell the person, we want you to report every day to pretrial services, or I want pretrial services to contact your employer every day to make sure you're going to work because for some reason your risk is related to whether you go to work or not. They don't have people to do that. Their choice is let you go and tell you when to come back, or grant a motion for detention. It's a, you know, it's not a very nuanced way to deal with people who present different kinds of risks. So I appreciate that the legislature has listened and understood why that's a better system than just leaving judges to their best, best efforts without a whole lot of information. We run, as I said, we run an overnight office here in Albuquerque to do PSAs. And where we've implemented pretrial services in the other counties, they're doing assessments for those counties. So if you get arrested in Sandoval County, there'll be a PSA. The judge will have a PSA, as will the prosecutor and the defense, in the morning or next afternoon, whenever you appear in front of the judge, because that PSA was run by the office we have here. And we'll do that for everybody in the state, except Bernalillo County, by the time we finish implementing, because the pretrial services, they do their own.
Okay.
So we do it for, we the AOC, we do it for the other counties. So San Juan County, Sandoval County, Doña Ana County, the three different counties that make up the 6th district in the southeastern part of the state. And our plans are next to go to the 1st district, which is Santa Fe, Rio Arriba, and Los Alamos counties and the other districts around the state. So while we definitely need more resources, we haven't had a problem with, we're moving deliberately. It takes a lot to get everybody on the same page to properly do pretrial services, but we found a lot of enthusiasm and the legislature has supported us and we appreciate that.
2022 will be an election year for legislators, for the governor, for district attorneys who...
So I hear.
Yes. Are you concerned at all that the balance that you described that results in a functioning system as it relates to funding, are you concerned that quote-unquote tough-on-crime legislation and funding will bring that out of balance and you will have more prosecutors, more police, but not other people on the other side?
No, because my experience, I've been a director at the AOC for 15 years. The legislature treats us on merit. That is, if we say, look, we need more judges here, we give them evidence why, the caseloads or whatever it is, they'll provide more judges. If we say we need to pay our people more because we're churning through clerks, and if you have unqualified clerks, you can have more mistakes, takes longer, and that's not good for anybody, they'll give us money to hire more clerks or run programs like pretrial services. I understand in the politics of things, the need to lock people up or the need to not lock people up depends. Treatment is a big discussion that's in the legislature. All of that, those are all difficult balances to strike. I'm not elected to strike those balances. Obviously, the courts will apply whatever laws that are passed by the legislature and signed by the governor. But the treatment we've had through lean times and times when we've been more flush tells me that, we'll be given the resources we need within the constraints that the legislature has to distribute not enough money for too many things. I mean, I'm not here to argue that the court should get money before education or social services or mental health. It seems like now there's enough money to maybe address a lot of issues. Sometimes there's not, and we don't, I'm not worried about that. Okay. I think there's difficult balances that the legislature has to make, and they make them as best they can, and we implement them, and they've been good to us.
Artie Pepin, thank you so much for your extra time. Appreciate it.
I'm glad to be here.